What's up, y'all? In this video, we're going to talk about how to create special matrices using built-in MATLAB functions. Sometimes in mathematics, we want to create matrices that have special structure. MATLAB is designed for just that type of play. In this video, we're going to focus on three MATLAB functions, the zeros function, the ones function, and also the I function. Let's start with the zeros function. That's Zeros. That's a built-in function in MATLAB. Of course, we could also learn more by typing help zeros, just as we've seen, gives a lot of information. We're gonna focus in on creating two-dimensional arrays, in other words, matrices. In order to do that using zeros, we type in zeros, open parentheses. First argument is the number of rows that we want. Second argument is the number of columns that we want, delimited or separated by a comma. And then of course we close parentheses. Once we produce that output, we can store that in a variable. In this case, we can choose any matrix names that conforms to the proper variable name patterns in MATLAB. For example, if I wanted to create a matrix Z that had all zero entries, and let's say that it had 6 rows and 4 columns, I could use the zeros functions to do that. Similarly, I could create a row vector, let's call it lowercase z, that has all zeros. So I type the zero function. Let's say that it has 1 row and 10 columns. I could also create a column vector that has all zeros. Let's say that it had 15 rows and 1 column. Those are all different mechanisms that I can use the zeros functions to create special matrices that have all zero values. Sometimes we don't want matrices that have all zero values, but instead all values equal to 1 or some scalar multiple times 1. In that case, we're going to use something called the ones function, that's O-N-E-S. To call the ones function to create two-dimensional arrays, matrices, we're going to type ones, open parentheses, number of rows that I want, comma, number of columns that I want, close parentheses, and then we can store the output using the appropriate naming paradigm. For example, if I wanted a matrix O that had all ones, perhaps it has 4 rows and 15 columns, notice that will produce the corresponding matrix O. If I wanted to know the size of O, I can just type in size of O. It should be a 4 by 15. It's exactly what MATLAB produces. This is super helpful for creating column vectors with all ones. So if I wanted, let's say, a 20 by 1 column vector, I could also do something called scalar multiplication, which we're going to get into in a bit. 3 times 1s. Notice that's going to give me a vector of all 3s. In a similar spirit, I could create a row vector of all 1s. Let's say that it had 1 row and 45 columns. Here we go. I could take that row vector and multiply it by, I don't know, -4 times that row vector, and that would give me a row vector that is 1 by 45 with all entries -4. The last special type of matrix we're going to talk about in this video is called the identity matrix. We're going to focus most heavily on square identity matrices since those come up pretty heavily in linear algebra. So we say that the n by n identity matrix is defined as I sub n, and that is a square matrix with real valued entries, has n rows and n columns. That matrix has very, very special structure. The element of those matrix where the row index is equal to the column index, values are 1, all other entries of that matrix are 0. In other words, entry 1, 1, we see that the row 1 index equals column 1 index, that has value 1. Entry 2, 2 has value 1. Entry 3, 3 has value 1. All the way to the end, entry n, n has value 1. Everything else has value 0. So entry 1, 2, first row, second column, value 0. The reason it's value 0 is the row index 1 is not equal to the column index 2. That has value 0. This definition we see here is the entry by entry definition because I'm actually specifying the identity matrix by writing all n squared entries in that matrix. On the bottom of the screen here, you see something called the piecewise definition corresponding to that entry by entry definition. Notice I sub n, the identity matrix, entry in row I, column k, gets the value 1 if the row index is equal to the column index. In other words, 1, 1 gets the value 1. The entry in address 2, 2 gets the value 1. Entry in address n, n gets the value 1 because I is equal to k in that case. On the other hand, if the row index is not equal to the column index, we say that the value of the identity matrix element is 0. Claim, the identity matrix is so powerful in linear algebra that MATLAB reserves a special function to create it. That's called the I function, spelled like the I on your head, E-Y-E. If I put a single dimension in, that will give me a square matrix. So for example, let's say that I wanted to create the 5x5 identity matrix I5. If I just type I5, MATLAB will give me the 5x5 identity matrix, all of whose non-diagonal elements are 0, the main diagonal elements, the elements whose row index is equal to the column index, are all equal to 1. I could do the same thing if I wanted to create the 10x10 identity matrix. I could type I of 10. Of course, I could equally do that by specifying that this matrix should have 10 rows and 10 columns. When I run that command, notice I get the 10x10 identity matrix. Things get a little bit interesting if I call I and I do a row index that is different than a column index. The same rule applies in that when we create that matrix, any entry whose row index equals the column index has value 1, all other entries have 0. In this case, it's as if I'm taking the first 5 columns of the 10x10 identity matrix. I could also reverse it. Let's say that I took 3 rows and 8 columns. Notice in that situation, the first 3 columns line up with what we expect. All other entries are 0. In general, when working on matrix algebra, it is most helpful to work with square identity matrices, but I wanted to show you the behavior of that function if the row index and the column index are different. That ends this video. We've seen the zeros, ones, and I function create special matrices. I promise, as we start to code up linear algebraic routines, we're going to come back to these functions. I'll see you in the next video.